Hi, everyone, and welcome to our Understanding IELTS Facebook Live. I'm joined, as always, by Neeraj. Hello, Neeraj.
Hello, Neil. Hello, everybody.
And we're here for the next 30 or 40 minutes to answer all of your questions about IELTS. And today, we're going to be speaking especially about the IELTS speaking test. Before we begin, though, I'll just catch up with Neeraj. How are things where you are today? How's the weather?
Oh, it's. Let me just check the thermometer. We are approaching 30 degrees here where I live in Barcelona, Spain, and it's getting hot and sticky. Luckily, I've got some air conditioning on, so I'm not too bad inside the house, but I've got to go out later, and I'm thinking, oh dear, I need my hat, I need my sunglasses, and I'm probably going to change into some shorts. Yeah, it's getting hot. Summer's on its way. How about you, Neil? What's it like where you are?
Yeah, 30 would be too much for me. It's not bad here at all today. It's 21 degrees and it's quite breezy. Yeah, it's just right. I can happily exist in this.
Neil's in Bratislava, Slovakia.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We're going to talk about where we live a little bit later. I'm in Bratislava. Neil is in Barcelona, and that will be important soon. You'll see why. So, as I said, we're going to talk about the speaking test today, and we're going to try something new. I'll talk about it a little bit later. We're going to give people a chance to speak. But first, let's talk about the course, you know, the Understanding IELTS course and speaking. And what are some of the things that people find difficult and that, you know, need to practice and so on to do well in this? You know,
there's lots of things. I think speaking is one of the things that people find most difficult to do well or to get good at, because primarily what people tend to say is, oh, I can practice reading on my own, I can practice listening on my own, I watch TV and read things on the internet, but I've got nobody to talk to. And then people lose confidence and they feel they haven't got enough practice with speaking, and they say, you know, I haven't got fluency. And this is people's principal problem, I think, in my experience working with students, and they kind of tend to neglect the speaking part. There are other components to speaking as well that people find difficult, depending also a little bit on your first language. For example, if your first language is close to English, then you're going to have less problems with things like pronunciation, because the sounds of your language correspond to English. So, for example, where I live in Spain, people speak Spanish and other languages too, but the languages are kind of related to English and the sounds are similar. Whereas in another part of the world, I don't know, for example, Japan, there's the sounds of the language are so different to English, and then you might not have in your language any some of the sounds of English, and you need to kind of really practice how to move your mouth and your tongue and the positions of your lips and all that stuff in order to make those sounds correctly. So that's another aspect. So you've got pronunciation, mm-hmm. and then you've got the kind of the usual suspects of vocabulary and grammar, which, you know, cause problems for people, not only in speaking, but in writing as well. So I think it's those are the kind of the main things that people generally have problems with.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and so we're here today to answer any questions that you have, especially about the speaking test in IELTS. So any questions you have, post in the comments. We'll talk about them all through the meeting today. But as I mentioned, we have a special experiment today because we want to hear you speaking. Because, you know, you can learn a lot about speaking from reading and writing and practice and so on. But the most important thing to practice with speaking is speaking. So what we have is an online voice recorder. And Tina and Sally, who are checking your questions, will share the link in the comments for this. You'll find the link there. And what we would like you to do is we would like you we're going to give you a question, an IELTS type question, and sometime in the next 30 minutes while we're talking, we would like you to take just 30 seconds or 1 minute and just record yourself and share the link with us. It's really easy to do. Once you see the link, all you have to do is click on the start recording button, and then you will see this. You can see the wave going up and down there. You just speak, record yourself like I'm doing just now, and then when you're finished, you press stop. And then once you press stop, you will have a choice to get a link. You'll have to click that twice. It asks for your name. You can put your name or not. It's up to you. But click get a link. And then once you've got that link, all we want you to do is copy it and paste it into the comments here on Facebook or YouTube. Okay? Once you've pasted that link, then we'll listen to some of them later and we'll give you some feedback and talk about what you've done. Okay, to give you an example, we've got one here. So I mentioned Tina is answering our questions, is sharing the link and answering questions. So Tina very kindly recorded an example for us earlier. So this is what it will look like when you do this. Bear with me. Okay. I beg your pardon. I've just done something wrong. Don't mind me. It's our first time doing this, so I expected some small problems, but here we go. Right. So here is what your message will be like. This is one that Tina recorded earlier.
Hello, everyone. I just wanted to tell you about where I live. So I live on the east coast of Italy, between the mountains and the sea. I live in a very small little village that's on top of a mountain. It's very high up. It's about 700 meters above sea level. It's a tiny little village, maybe with about 1,500 people, probably more, but I can't really remember. One of the things I love about this village is that everyone is so friendly. It's a great place to have a croissant and a coffee in the early morning and watch everyone going off to work. But it's also lovely to have a sundown in the evening. As I said before, you can see the sea from one side and the mountains from the other side. It gets very hot in the summer and very cold in the winter, and you get to see lots of snow.
Okay, so that's what it will sound like and how it will work for you. Tina's very talkative. You don't have to do as much as that if you don't want. Just even 30 seconds is plenty for us. Now, Fiveda Noor is asking, what's the question I should be answering? That's a very good question, and we will come to that right now. This is the question that we would like you to answer. Okay, I'm going to leave this on the screen while Neeraj and I talk about other things and answer your questions. So anytime during the next, I guess, 25 minutes now or something, you can just go off, record yourself, and share the link. And then later in the show, we'll listen to some of them and talk about them. So this is the question. Let's talk about your hometown or village. Well, Neeraj, let's do that. We mentioned that you're in Barcelona. Tell me a little bit about it. What kind of place is Barcelona to live?
That's right. And there's even in the image there, that's an image from Barcelona itself. And if I was to describe the kind of place Barcelona is, I think I'd start off by saying it's a medium-sized city. It's in fact the second biggest city in Spain after the capital city, Madrid. And it's geographically speaking, it's a city on the coast. And that's one of the things I really love about the city. Its geography is really unique. I'm originally from London, which is a geographically speaking, relatively boring city because it's not got too many features. Mm. But Barcelona is great because it has the Mediterranean Sea. It's got a coastline, and it's sandwiched between two rivers on the east and the west. I should say the north and the south. And behind the city, there's a line of small mountains or hills. And so it's kind of boxed in within this area. You've got the coast, the mountains, and a river on either side. And that's great because for a medium-sized city, you've got the chance to go to the sea or go to the beach in the summer. If you like hiking in the autumn, in the spring, you can walk through the mountains and there are forests. And there are even some interesting wild animals roaming around the forest just outside of the city. They're kind of these wild pigs. We call them boars in English. So there's lots of opportunities for seeing wildlife. And that's even, you're even in a big city. Yeah. What else is Barcelona famous for? Well, architecture, I think. That's what tourists come to see. Definitely there's an architectural movement that's world famous here called modernism, and one of the architects is somebody called Gaudi. And if you know anything about Barcelona, you'll have seen the church, or I think it's not a church, it's a basilica that he designed and built, and it's still not finished. They're still building it 100 years later. Fingers crossed it'll be finished sometime soon. Mm-hmm. And the name is Sagrada Familia, the sacred family church.
Okay, so everyone watching will have noticed that I love Barcelona as well. It's a wonderful city. So Neeraj had plenty to say about it. There was no shortage of details there. He talked quite a lot, but he gave a lot of interesting, useful information. You know, so what would you say about that, Neeraj? About that idea of like giving more detail and keeping talking, because I just asked you a really simple question. Well, really, didn't I? I said, you know, where do you live? What's it like?
Yeah. It's easy to say the minimum and just say, well, it's okay, I like it. And then you're answering the question, right? Mm-hmm. But you have to think that in IELTS, the examiners, they're looking for evidence, demonstration of your language. They're looking for vocabulary, grammatical mm-hmm. structures, fluency, connections between sentences, and all these things justifies a higher score. And so if you don't give those things, they can't justify giving you more points. So you've got to add in as much information and show off your English. So it's a little bit like, it's a bit of a show. And it's not maybe realistic. You know, in a real conversation, you might say a lot less. Mm. But in the IELTS exam, you've got to switch on. I tell my students, you've got to switch on the English chip and you know, demonstrate all that vocabulary and grammar, which is why I gave this long, extended answer, just show you what's possible, what you could say in reference to your city.
Okay. We're going to move on from that a little. Just for everyone watching, just to explain once more what we would like you to do, is we've shared the link in the comments for you to record yourself. It's very simple. You go there, you press the button, you record yourself, and then come back and post the link in the comments here on Facebook. While you're doing that and while other things are happening, we're going to answer all your questions and talk about lots of other things and lots of advice. But I'll leave the question up on the screen so that at any time that you decide, okay, I'm ready to record, you can go and do it. Okay, so that question will stay there just now, but we're going to move on and talk about some other things. Let me just say we've got people watching us from all over at the moment. I'm not quite sure some of the places that are there, South Korea, Bangladesh, China, and other places that work with that. There's a bunch of there.
Somebody's just joined us from Mexico.
Mexico, yep. Lots of them popping up there. Great. So we hope to hear from you a little bit later and everything else to do with that. Let's begin with some questions from the course, from people who have asked some questions on the course recently. Now, you mentioned a moment ago about vocabulary as one of the things. Obviously, you mentioned pronunciation, giving detailed answers, grammar, vocabulary, and everything. Emmanuel Meza is asking, okay, how do I retain and remember this new vocabulary? How can I be sure that I can use that vocabulary when the time is right and when I need it? What would you say to Emmanuel?
Yeah, so you know, when you come across a new word, I think the key is to make sure you record that word. So don't just, you know, hear it and say, oh, okay, right, I know what it means, and then move on, because you'll forget that word most probably. Write it down somewhere. But apart from just writing it down, make sure you write down that word in a sentence, so you get that word in its context and you can see how it works in a sentence. If you've got a bit more time, you've got your phone next to you or computer next to you, investigate that word's pronunciation. So if it's not an easy word to pronounce, copy the phonetic transcription, if you know how phonetic transcriptions work, or whatever transcription you use in order to help you to pronounce the word correctly, identify its syllables, and write down a translation, perhaps in your language, what that word means in your language. So you've got plenty of information about that word. You've worked with that word, and that will help you to remember it even more clearly. So the more you work with a word, the more information you write down a word, the more chance it has of sticking in your brain. But that's just the first part. That's when you first encounter that word. Then you've got to do the work of remembering it. So that requires recycling, because you know our memory decays over time. And I don't mean in old age, I mean when you learn something new within a day or within just a few hours, you could forget that new thing. So you need to review it. And you could do it the old-fashioned way by using little cards. I'm going to hold up some post-it notes on my camera here. You could write down words on post-it notes and have them stuck to your wall, your mirror. There are now apps on the phone that do this for you electronically, and you take it with you. You know, you're on the bus and you can check the new words you've learned. So doing that regularly keeps the words in your memory, in your vocabulary. I hope those tips, Emmanuel.
Yeah, I was just going to say, what I was typing while you were speaking there was, I was thinking when you were talking about the, you know, writing down the pronunciation and stuff like that. All good online dictionaries now have the audio as well, so you can hear the words. That's right. Like you say, you can use, you don't need to learn how to write phonemic script or something. You can just write it down in any way that works for you. But there's also a thing, you know, like how do you say, you know, the website where you can hear like phrases and even short sentences, so you can hear the whole thing if you're not sure. So I've just put a link in to that in the comments as well.
And you've just reminded me of another great website, which is called Youglish. And what it does, it searches YouTube for examples of that word. So let's say you hear a new word and you think, okay, how else could this word be used? If you pop the word into Youglish, it'll search through interviews and videos and clips and find, you know, I don't know, an actor using that word in the sentence, and then you'll hear different pronunciations and also the word in context.
And lots of different kind of accents and everything as well, as you say. So that's great. Nadosh in Libya is just commenting on what you said there and saying, an effective way is to learn and keep that word, put it in a sentence, then check how it's pronounced. It's as you mentioned, I mean, you know, context and sentences and collocations and phrases and so on is much easier to remember and will help you to remember better than just long lists of words very often. Okay. Just for anyone just joining us, if they're wondering about the screen at the right-hand side with the question, that's because we want you to answer this question, record yourself, and send it to us. And if you just keep watching the comments, Tina and Sally are sharing the link there and the instructions for how you can do that. So I hope before we finish, we'll get a few people, a few brave people who have answered the question, and we can hear their answers. Okay. Okay, here's an interesting question about that from Nino Papashvili, who's saying, just joined in. Are we supposed to mention the name of our hometown or keep it secret and you'll try to guess it? We'd love to guess, but this is for IELTS, so it's more important. Neeraj, you were talking about this earlier. Is this a common problem that people, a common mistake people sometimes make?
Yeah, I think people get so focused on the question, what kind of place is it? What's the most interesting part? And, you know, they kind of forget to give a little bit of background information. So if I start saying, okay, I live in a place that's next to the sea and it's got some mountains and some rivers and famous architecture, the examiner might be thinking, yeah, all right, well, that's very nice, but it would be nice to know also where in the world that place is. And so if you say, well, I live in Barcelona, which is a city in the northeast of Spain, that just gives a bit of context. In a normal, like, let's say a conversation with a friend in the street, you would say that.
Yeah.
So don't forget to include that.
I mean, like Nino says, if you don't do that, it's a bit of a guessing game. It's like, oh, okay, fine. You're in a city with mountains and sea. Yes. Mm-hmm. And you don't want that, do you? You want to just actually talk about and describe everything. Okay, lots of people joining us from Mexico, Libya, the USA, Chichester, the Philippines, Nepal, Pakistan, India, Morocco, Cameroon, Glasgow. Okay, my favorite city in Scotland. Okay. Someplace that I don't know, I guess it's possibly in Italy from the name Crotone. Have you heard of that?
No. Nope. I've not heard of it, no.
Okay. From Ukraine, from Pakistan, from lots more. Okay, so if you have any questions about the speaking test, just pop them into the comments and we'll try and answer them. In the meantime, we'll carry on with our questions here. And of course, we're waiting for your recordings to come in. Now, this I like this question. It's kind of it covers, you know, it's something that goes back to what you were saying about making sure that you get the pronunciation right, because English spelling is not phonetic, and you know, if you're learning without communicating with other people and learning just from reading or mainly from reading, it's very easy to actually get the wrong pronunciation of words. And Cosa Cristina's saying, Why is the pronunciation of letters not respected within the word? One time it's pronounced one way, another time it's pronounced another way. Why?
I mean, there are...
Interesting.
It's fascinating. I mean, you could read about this, and there are lots of things you could watch about this, but it's basically the history of the development of English over time. And what's happened is that English has changed so much over the years, but when it was recorded, when people started to write down English was still changing. So the pronunciations changed after the spellings were standardized, and so that explains a lot of why the spelling system of English is not very regular compared to other languages, where each letter has one sound. Mm-hmm. English has one letter can have multiple sounds or combinations of letters of multiple sounds. And this is one of the most difficult aspects. Even for native English speakers to learn spellings takes a long time. And quite often at schools, there are classes dedicated to spellings, competitions. We call them spelling bees. And they're very popular TV programs. There's one on UK TV at the moment, which is dedicated to spelling. Yeah.
And I think it's fair to say that most native speakers of English have some words that perhaps they've only come across in reading, some less common words. And, you know, they actually, you know, very often pronounce them wrong until they hear it in another context. I mean, that's happened to everyone I know, I think, that, you know, there's a word that you only very occasionally see, and for years you use it, and then you realize, you know, later in life,
I'm saying it wrong.
Huh? Yeah, I've been saying it wrong all my life.
It's not quinoa, it's quinoa.
Yeah, exactly. And you know, there's a lot of exactly words from different languages and so on, and the spelling. Right. That covers everything, that. I mean, you know, silent letters as well. You know, silent letters are from history. We don't say them anymore, but they used to be there. And so that's why. It's not very helpful. It's not great for people learning, but, you know, you just have to learn.
Well, I would say there are patterns, and... For example, certain combinations of letters do produce certain sounds quite regularly. So, for example, the double O tends to produce the O sound, boot, for example, or the short us sound like foot. So you can see irregularities with this, with some of these letter combinations.
Most of the time, and then you come to blood and flood, and then you just forget. Yeah. Okay, great. Okay, question. As I said, just for everyone watching, just I'm going to keep reminding you all through the show here just now, because we really would like to get some of your recordings. Follow the link that you will find in the comments. Record 30 seconds of you speaking, and then we'll play it at the end of the show today. Question from Gabby Fawn, who's saying, what is IELTS UKVI? How is it different from IELTS General and Academic? Is there a different way to approach the tests? There's no difference in the content of the test, is there?
No. It's exactly the same test in terms of the exercises and the tasks. And the only difference is there are some additional security procedures. So, for example, there are cameras in the room where you do the speaking part, whereas in the other version of IELTS, there's just a recorder for recording voice. And what the VI means, it's visas and immigration. So yeah. It has extra security so that it makes the test appropriate for the UK visa and immigration authorities. So it's yeah. for people who are applying only for the UK for a visa for immigration purposes.
Yeah. So that's important to remember, that it's only for, when you're actually applying for a visa for immigration purposes. If you're going to another country or it's for study someplace else and so on, it's not required. So make sure that you know exactly which form of IELTS you need. But the test itself, as Neeraj says, exactly the same. The same four parts, the same questions, the same format, everything for that. Okay. Another question here from Michelle Castor Carnani. In IELTS speaking, should the tone be formal or casual and natural? And also, does accent count? Very good questions there. Very important things for people to be aware of. Neeraj, what would you say to this?
I would say go for natural. But just bearing in mind, you don't want to be too informal. You're not talking to a friend as such. The examiners are, friendly, polite, they're nice people. It's not a formal job interview, but then again, it's not a friend. So you want to be natural. You want to be relaxed. You don't want to be really nervous. Thinking what to avoid saying and what not to say. So mm-hmm. be natural. But it's not as informal as a chat with your regular English teacher, for example. It might not be that level of informality.
Don't sit back and put your feet on the table. No.
Don't swear. I've had that question a few times. What if I say something rude in the exam if it escapes?
We actually had a question earlier, not about swearing. No one was saying, can I swear at the examiner? I'm sure sometimes people feel like it. But we had a question earlier, which was about slang. And is it okay to use like slang and so on in the test? What would you say to that?
You've got to be really careful. You have to know your slang really well. I mean, because if you use slang inappropriately, it can sound at best strange, out of place, and at worst rude. So avoid it if you have any doubts. But if you've heard that word used, if you use it yourself a lot and you're confident about the way it works and if it fits properly, it's not going to be it's not going to be taken inappropriately. It might work, but I would say be cautious in an exam situation.
Okay. Good advice there. I mean, as you mentioned earlier, it's important to be natural because you've got enough to worry about with, communicating clearly and getting your ideas across. You don't want to be worrying about, getting the formal tone just right or something, or choosing words that you don't use often in order to do that. Okay. What about Michelle's second question about accent? Does accent count? Everyone wonders about this and asks about this.
Yeah. There's in the evaluation criteria that the examiners use, they're listening for your pronunciation. And this is where the idea of accent would perhaps have an impact. If somebody has a very strong accent and it means that it's difficult to understand them because of their accent, then it could affect your score negatively. You could lose points because the accent's preventing comprehension. But, you know, everybody, even native English speakers, have an accent depending on where they're from, you know, where they've learned their English. And so it's natural to have an accent. In the IELTS, what's evaluated is communication and comprehension. So independent of your accent, you can still get the maximum score for pronunciation as long as you're clear and easily understood.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It's something, as you say, I mean, it's, people worry about it, I think, very often just too much, and it's not, you know, it's not something that I would try to, hold on, I'm just looking for something. Okay, let me move on to another question very quickly before I talk again about our recording in a second. Animal Hack Uzal saying, this is a very good question. Is building a story in part two really essential? What if I just describe this question without building a story? This is exactly what we're kind of talking about today, isn't it? We're going to talk about this a bit more in a minute. Maybe a story, you know, let's talk about this. I mean, part two is where you're given a topic to discuss and some bullet points. So, you know, it could be tell us about, I don't know, a gift that was very special for you or something like that. Who gave it to you? What was it? Why was it important? Something like that. Now, you could just answer those questions and go, oh, yeah, my watch, my mother gave it to me when I was 21, and, you know, I just really, whatever. You could just say that, but that's not really what you want to do, is it?
Yeah, because if you end up just answering the questions in that way, you'll probably finish talking about the topic in under a minute. And the idea of this task is that you talk for 2 minutes. And what the examiner is listening for is your fluency, your ability to keep talking, keep developing that subject. It's a monologue, basically. The examiner is not going to interact with you during this part, except if you finish early, and then they might do something with their fingers and, you know, and make a face at you. So really the objective here is to keep talking for 2 minutes. How do you keep talking for 2 minutes? Well, it could be that building a story around the idea of the topic helps you to talk for 2 minutes. So, you know, as you were saying, Neil, talk about a time when you were given a gift. Mm. Well, that's a story, you know. Whereas another question type might be talk about a famous building in your city. It may or may not be a story for you. You may not know enough about that building to be able to tell the story, but you know, regardless of what you know about the building, you can still say how you feel about it, how many times you visited it, whether you would like to go there in the future. Telling a story isn't the objective necessarily, but it could be useful because good storytellers are people that talk a lot generally, so that helps.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm just going to remind people one more time about the recording part. So I'm just going to pop something up on the screen here for them, and then we're going to go and talk about something else. So remember, what we want is for you to record yourself. The link is in the comments, and you can find it there. And, you know, we have maybe less than 10 minutes to go before we finish today. So we'd really like you to send some to us, and then we'll listen to them. We had a question from someone saying, will we be able to listen to this afterwards? Yes, this recording will be available on Facebook and YouTube. You can listen back to it. And, you know, if your recordings of you speaking come in later, then we'll listen to them later as well and possibly get back to you and make some comments about that as well. Okay, for the meantime, I'm going to stay off camera for a second and bring something else up. So, Neeraj, now, I'm just a disembodied voice. I'm here, but not here. The question that we've asked people to record, or the questions, you know, these are questions that would come up in part one of the speaking test, aren't they? What happens right in part one? Tell me a little bit about that.
Yeah, so this is the first 5 minutes or so of the IELTS speaking test, and the examiner is going to ask you questions about three topic areas, and the questions are about your opinion and your about how, I don't know, about your habits and the kinds of topics are usually things that people have experience of, and they're everyday topics. All right. So, for example, like we've got this topic here about sport. A question like this: do you like sport? It's could be a typical question in part one. And as you can see here, we've got a very simple answer. Yes, I like it very much. That is the answer to that question. It's a possible answer to the question.
True, yeah.
Mm-hmm. As we've been saying earlier, we've been talking about, does it show a lot of English? Not really. It's quite a basic answer. Is there more that we could say and in order to show off our English? Absolutely, yeah. Yes. So how could we make this a better answer?
So what I would like to ask people watching is, we're going to show you a few questions at the moment that are typical questions you might get in the IELTS test. And, you know, what could you say? So what could you say more? Maybe just type your answers into the comments and we'll have a look at what we could say. So do you like sport? Okay. You heard Neeraj talking earlier about where he lives and about the city he lives. You heard how much he had to say about it. You heard Tina talking about where she lives and how much she had to say about everything, the details and everything. So what about for you? If we asked all of the people who are watching, do you like sport? Okay. Your answer is going to be yes, no, a little, perhaps. One of these three. But what could you say to make that answer better? What other things could you talk about? So type your ideas in the comments and we'll bring some of these up onto the screen. I'm going to show you a couple of other questions. Well, let's just talk about that one a little bit more. So sport, What else could we talk about sport, for example? That could
I had a fourth option. You said yes, no, or maybe a little. There's another option. There's the it depends option as well, which I love, because it's it gives you the chance to say it depends. If it's a team sport, I'm really keen on anything that's a team sport. I love playing games with other people. So football, hockey, any of those kind of sports would be my cup of tea.
You just reminded me there of something that my students sometimes do that can be a problem, is sometimes with something like this, they start on a list.
Right. Yes. Go, yes.
Football,
yeah.
Hockey, tennis. I like boxing. I like rugby, and I like and then it becomes a long list, and that's it. But what would you say about that?
Yeah, it's okay to say a few examples. Ooh, yeah. But you know, keep it to that. Don't just give the examiner a shopping list of all the sports you like and don't like. It's not a vocabulary test. It's a test about speaking about the question.
Okay, we've got an excellent answer here from Hagar Elgani. I like playing it more than watching it. That's a really nice way to kind of go into then talking about it, isn't it?
Yeah, I say so. And that gives you the opportunity to say one or two more sentences about why you like playing it more than watching it. Mm-hmm. In fact, that's one of the techniques for expanding an answer to give a reason.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Great. And Andrei Sherbach, will it be okay if I don't like sport much, but my favorite is to watch soccer on TV, having beer and chips, and to say
spelling problem. Yeah,
that's yeah. Be careful with the spelling. So check on that. We'll maybe make a comment for you about that later. But the answer itself, I think, is really good. I mean, he's saying, okay, I don't like sport too much, but I like watching football on TV, drinking beer, and eating chips. Is it okay to answer that for do you like sport?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's all right in this part of the exam to give that kind of an answer.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's the truth. He's telling the truth. And
yes, the examiner's not, you know, they're not evaluating on you on how you live.
Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, I mean, as you say, you could expand on the answer a bit more as why doesn't like sport much, or past experience or something like that. But it's again, it's a nice way to go in. Animal Hack Uzal, yes, I do. I'm rather fond of playing football. Whenever I get a spare moment, I tend to play football with my friends. What would you say about that?
Oh, I love that answer. That's great. I like that, because he's showing the examiner that emphatic use of the I do. Mm-hmm. And fond of, I'm rather fond of. That's a nice phrase there. It's another way of saying I really like. So that's showing more advanced vocabulary there.
Nino Papashvili's got an answer here as well. I really enjoy doing sports outdoors, with a city bike being my favorite so far. I have a couple of reasons I like it very much, because it makes me more energetic and fades out my eight-hour workday routine. Again, lots of nice detail there.
Great, yeah. What is it? Two or three sentences. Yeah. Two sentences, a long answer, lots of information. I like it.
And we've got lots more coming in as well. Susanna Saturian. Okay. How could you maybe build on this one a little more, Neeraj, would you think? What recommendation would you give for Susanna?
It's a good start. What I can see with this question, a lot of people are saying, I like it, I don't like it, I really like it. Could you think of another way to say like? So in a previous answer, one of the participants said, I'm fond of. Mm-hmm. Another way to say like is I'm keen on or I'm into. Those would be good ways of saying I like. Alternatives to show vocabulary.
Okay. We're running out of time a little, but let me just try another question, because this is going very well so far and we're getting some wonderful answers. I apologize. I skipped forward two there. No, I didn't. I'm right. Okay. Getting a little bit more personal. coming in from sport in general, let's talk about this. Do you get on well with your family? Yes, I mostly get on well with them. Now, you know, family is something that no matter what your situation, everyone's got experience of family. You know, not everyone necessarily has family still alive or something, but mostly, you know, there's something you can talk about with this. What could you say to this? How could you make this answer better, do you think, Neeraj? What directions could you go in?
So the answer here on the screen, it starts well, but it's too short. So what we need to do to expand this, I would say, is to add the word because. I mostly get on well with them because we're into the same things. We meet regularly and we enjoy meals together, that kind of stuff. And then you might say, is it because of the word mostly, that suggests there are occasions where you don't get on well.
Exactly. Yeah.
So we could also introduce those occasions as well with a contrast connector. So this means using a word like, however, on occasions we argue about politics, or although sometimes if the question of sports comes up, we have lots of arguments because we support different teams. Mm-hmm. So there's an opportunity to use those connectors.
So again, this simple question actually opens up a whole range of possibilities, because even if you get on well with your family, perhaps you don't always get on well with them. So you can take that and, as you say, use a contrastive kind of term to kind of move into that. But however, and again, maybe you get on well with most of your family, but not all of your family. Mm-hmm. So you could break it down into that as well. I get on especially well with my brother and sister. My older brother or something like that, you know, move into that. Lots of possibilities. So for the people watching, just give us your ideas here. What would you say? Tell us about yourself. Do you get on well with your family? And then just give us more information. Could you share to develop your answer a little more there?
You might want to use adverbs of frequency here as well. Mm-hmm. So generally, usually, most, hardly ever speak
to them. We occasionally argue, but not very often, or something like that, stuff like that. Okay, so yeah, let's see how that's going. We're actually running out of time, so I would like to just see your answers to this. Unfortunately, I was hoping for the recordings to come in before we finished, but it doesn't look like that's happened today. We'll work on this. We'll try this again next week, I think, and maybe give you a chance before we come on to kind of do this, to see if we can get this to work. But it's not too late. As I mentioned before, bear with me. What's happened? Yeah, the link is in the chat, and if you follow the link and follow the instructions shared by Sally and Tina, then we'll be able to hear your recording and then talk about it a little and give you a little feedback, which I think will be really interesting for that. Okay, so just before we finish, for anyone watching just now, let's give us your ideas for this last question. Do you get on well with your family? Imagine that you're in your IELTS test and you've done the introductions and the examiner says something like, okay, so let's talk about your family. Do you get on well with your family? What would you say to make this answer better? Let's see. We've still got people answering on the sport one. Okay. I'm just going through the rest. Okay. While we're maybe just waiting for that one last question to finish off with. Bear with me.
Maybe people are a bit shy about talking about their families.
Yeah, sports, maybe.
It's a more neutral topic. Everybody can talk about sports.
Mm-hmm. Obviously. Okay, last question from Danny Nascimento. We spoke a lot about pronunciation and about vocabulary. Danny's got a question about grammar, which are there some structures that you don't recommend to use? Is there such a thing as something you wouldn't recommend someone to use in speaking, for example?
By structures, I understand grammar. So yeah. I understand that what yeah. Danny's saying is that is there some grammar that we should avoid? Mm. I would say that there isn't really what mm. If you can use it, then it's in your language, right? It's in yep. your English, and you wouldn't say it if you're not able to use it. So, you know, I would say speak naturally, use the English that you're confident that you're able to use. If you are able to use grammatical structures which are more advanced, like conditional structures or passive forms, mm-hmm. then that's great, because they're demonstrating to the examiner your level, and you should definitely see if you can say those.
Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess the only things that I would think about, I mean, there's definitely, as you say, there's nothing you shouldn't use if it's part of your personal communication style and the way that you communicate. I mean, you know, of course, why not use it? Maybe some things that kind of are a little bit overly formal sometimes. Mm-hmm. I might think about that maybe there are some things that you learn that are more suitable for writing, that when you say them in speaking doesn't quite sound natural. But that's the only thing I would kind of, it wouldn't be a problem, I guess. But I mean, I'm just thinking, you know, in the wider world,
yeah,
your general communication yeah. style or something, it might be worth thinking about. What would you say to that?
Yeah, I'd agree with you. Perhaps those structures, in terms of grammatical structures, those are maybe passives. Mm. In speaking, we'd prefer more active style structures. Mm. This person mm. did that, and that person did this, mm-hmm. rather than it was done by this person. Mm. But it's a difficult one, because it yeah. depends on what you're talking about. You know, in part three of the speaking test, if they're talking about what should governments do to improve the environment, mm. then passives could be appropriate.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So, yeah.
Yeah, it's not an easy one to pinpoint. I think in terms of vocabulary, there we can definitely say there's yeah. words or phrases which we would generally tend to yeah. avoid, like idiomatic language. Mm-hmm. Because it's so dependent on the context and your ability to know when it's appropriate.
Okay, we're over time, but we have some fantastic answers coming in now for this question. So I'm just going to pop them up on the screen before we finish and just quickly go through some of the ones that have come in. Asiel Kaisi saying, the question was, do you get on well with your family? Asiel's answer is, absolutely, yes, because my family gives me more love and confidence to be strong with other people around me. It's a nice answer.
Yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Nino again has come up with, due to the fact I live abroad, I get along quite well. I get on well with my family members, since we usually chat on Messenger and make video calls occasionally. There's simply no chance for us to argue with each other.
I know what you're saying.
It's a good point. Yeah. Yeah. Yep. chatting online and communicating with your family by video calls and stuff like that. Yeah, it's definitely much less likely to lead to arguments than all being together mm-hmm. for some family event or something, I'm sure. Okay.
But I like the way she's used a couple of adverbs of frequency there in that sentence mm-hmm. really appropriately.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And a little emphasis there as well. There's simply no chance for us. That's great as well. So lots of nice language there. Nana Adwa Agupama Owusu takes it a little bit further and talks about the cultural situation and says, we have two types of family, the nuclear family and the extended family. I get on well with my nuclear family because we live together in an apartment and share most things, unlike my extended family where we all live apart and meet yearly for a family get together. Mm. Okay. Again, very nice extended answer there with lots of interesting points.
Would you say nuclear family?
It depends. Is that more
a sociological term? It does exist, nuclear family, yeah. But it's kind of...
It's not an everyday term that people use. That's true. I mean, it might be more natural to use something like close family. Yeah, I guess. Mm-hmm.
We understand you.
Yeah, and perhaps Nana's a sociologist, so it's, who knows? Okay, and that's it. So, like, we've run out of time. We've gone way over time. My only comment for you before we go is I'm just going to leave this up there just while we say goodbye. We'd still like to hear your recordings. The links are in the comments. When you have time, just send us a link to your recording, and we'd love to hear it, and we'll give you some feedback on it. Okay. Neeraj, just to finish off, you want to say a little bit more about the course and stuff, and then we'll say goodbye?
Yeah, for anybody who doesn't know about the courses or who is preparing for IELTS or who has an exam coming up, I would definitely recommend you check out our Understanding IELTS courses, which can help anybody in any stage of their preparation. The first week is free for you to use and to try, and you've got the opportunity there on the courses to record yourself, watch videos, try quizzes, pick up lots of tips for the exam, and download materials for your preparation. So, and there are learners from all over the world participating on those courses. So you're not alone. You can interact with people and get support for your preparation. So definitely check them out if you haven't already.
Okay, great. And so thank you everyone for watching. Thanks for all your wonderful answers to the speaking questions that we were talking about there. And again, we still hope that we'll hear some of your recordings coming in after we finish. And we'll see you in another week or so. So bye for now.
Bye-bye, everybody. Thank you.